Welcome again. Hello students. Well, in the last class we talked about standard reduction potential series and we talked about applications of that. As you can see here, applications of standard reduction potential series. In today's class we will be doing another topic, that is effect of temperature and concentration on the EMF of a cell. Well, when I'm saying this thing, I'm basically talking about Nernst equation. So we'll derive this equation, Nernst equation. We'll see what does that means and what this application and what this equation is all about. Well, whenever I'm talking about effect of temperature and concentration on the EMF of a cell, temperature automatically means that I'm talking about thermodynamics. So here in this topic, we'll be taking an equation which is from thermodynamics, and it basically involves the concentration part also. So there is an equation in thermodynamics that will involve concentration part of a cell. So that will relate the EMF of a cell with the temperature and the concentration. Now before that, we'll again take the same cell as a our example, that is the Daniell cell. You know, we can represent it by Zn, single line, Zn2 positive, C2, that is the concentration of ZnSO4, double line, Cu2 positive, single line, C1, single line, Cu. Zn, single line, Zn2 positive, concentration is Cu2, double line, Cu2 positive, C1, single line, Cu. Where C2 and C1 are the concentration of Zn2 positive and Cu2 positive respectively. Well, if I talk about this equation, I can write it like Zn plus Cu2 positive gives me Zn2 positive plus Cu. If I consider it as a reversible reaction, that if it's a reversible reaction, that means it will definitely have an equilibrium. And if it will have an equilibrium, it is definitely going to have an equilibrium constant. So in this case, suppose the equilibrium constant, that is Kc. Equilibrium constant is always the concentration of product divided by the concentration of reactant. So here in this case, it is Zn2 positive upon concentration of Cu2 positive. Well, as for the concentration of Cu and Zn are concerned, since they are in the pure state, their concentration is unity. So we'll not write that in equilibrium constant. I was talking about an equation of thermodynamics that basically relates concentration and temperature. The equation is actually delta G is equal to delta G naught plus RT ln Kc. Well, I expect that you people know what Gibbs energy is. Delta G is change in Gibbs energy. Gibbs energy is the part of internal energy that is used to do work other than the work of expansion. In thermodynamics, a very common work is the work of expansion, that is P delta V. So if you have got any other work done other than P delta V, the part of internal energy which is used to do that is Gibbs energy. In a cell, we have electrical work done. So whenever there is a work done, there is always a decrease in Gibbs energy. So therefore, I can say minus delta G, minus N represents decrease in Gibbs energy, is equal to electrical work. Now, if I talk about electrical work, that is always given by NFE, where N is the number of moles of electron transferred, F is the Faraday's constant, and E is the EMF of a cell. If I use this part in this equation, it becomes minus NFE is equal to minus NFE naught plus RT ln Kc. Now what I can do, I can change all the signs and I can divide the whole equation by NF. In that case, it will become E is equal to E naught minus RT by NF Allen KC. Now I am representing this E. Actually, it represents basically the EMF of the cell. So I can say EMF of a cell is equal to E naught of cell minus, I'm changing this natural log to the log to the base 10. So I will multiply it by 2.303, so minus 2.303 RTNF log KC. Well, this equation is known as the Nernst equation. And this equation is used to calculate EMF of a cell at temperature other than standard and concentration other than standard. We can use this equation for Daniell cell. So for Daniell cell, as you know, we have already calculated the value of KC. We will write it here. So for that, it is EMF of cell is equal to E naught of cell minus 2.303 RT upon, now the value of N will become 2, because in this equation you can see that 2 moles of electrons they are transferred. Zn is losing 2 moles of electron and copper is gaining those 2 moles of electron. So value of N will become 2. F is the Faraday's constant, log KC. KC, as I have already shown you for Daniell cell, so it is concentration of Zn2 positive divided by concentration of Cu2 positive. So this is the Daniell, this is the Nernst equation for a Daniell cell. Students, many a time you have been asked to calculate EMF of a cell. The concentrations are not standard, but the temperature is standard. So it may happen that this temperature is given to you and that is 298 Kelvin. So what I can say, at 298 Kelvin, when I know the temperature is 298 Kelvin, I know the value of R, I know the value of Faraday's constant. So putting all these constants, the equation becomes EMF of cell is equal to E naught of cell minus 0.0591 upon N, here in this case it is 2, log concentration of Zn2 positive upon concentration of Cu2 positive. So this will give you the EMF of the cell at standard temperature when the concentration is not standard. Whereas for I could recall and expect that you people know how to calculate E naught of cell, because this is what I have already taught you. E naught of cell is always equal to E naught of cathode minus E naught of anode. I taught you this thing in the last class. So many a time a representation of a cell will be given to you, like Zn. I am just giving you a hypothetical question. Zn, single line Zn2 positive, say the concentration is 0.01, double line Cu2 positive, the concentration is 0.1 Cu. In that case, reduction potential, that is E0, Zn2 positive single line Zn will be given to you. Likewise, E0 Cu2 positive single line Cu will also be given to you. So by using these two values, that is E0 of Zn and E0 of copper, you can calculate E0 of cell. You'll put it in the above equation and you'll get the EMF of cell at standard temperature by putting the concentration values here. So this is all about EMF at non-standard condition or Nernst equation. Now next we'll talk about corrosion. We'll see what corrosion means, corrosion or rusting means. Well, if we talk about corrosion, air contains large number of non-metal oxides, like it contains carbon dioxide, It contains sulfur dioxide, it contains nitrous oxide. These oxides, they combine with moisture, and it largely happens for carbon dioxide. Rest of them, they are always in traces. So when they combine with this non-metal oxide, they form their protic acid, like carbonic acid in case of carbon dioxide, or sulfurous acid in case of SO3, SO2, and nitrous acid in case of NO. All these acids, they are protic acids. That means they are capable of donating H positive ions. So from all these acids, H positive ions, they can be donated. And it is these H positive ions which are responsible for corrosion or rusting. Actually, what happens, suppose I'll explain that to you by taking an example of iron. Suppose here in this case, I've got an iron block. And on this iron block, a moisture drop is sitting. Now, what is happening? That moisture has got H positive ion, as I have shown you. So it will gain electron from iron. It will take electron. So what will happen here? You'll get an equation like 2 moles of H positive plus Fe will become Fe2 positive plus hydrogen. This is what oxidation and this is what corrosion is. This is what rusting is. Rusting always starts from the surface. So after some time, what will happen? The iron at the surface will get converted to Fe2 positive. After that, what will happen? The iron inside, that is in the bulk, will start supplying electrons to the iron at the surface, because the iron at the surface is in the form of cations. Cations, they are always more electronegative than a neutral atom. So they will gain electron from iron in the bulk. As a result of that, we can say a miniature cell is formed, a small cell is formed, where the surface behaves like a cathode and the bulk, it behaves like an anode. So rusting, although it rusting means oxidation, although it has started from the surface, but it is moving to the bulk. And this is how corrosion occurs. Now, if we want to prevent corrosion, what we can do? Well, in that case, we can protect, we can do surface protection. Surface protection means what? We can paint the surface of the metal, we can oil it, we can coat it with a less reactive metal, like in case of iron, we do tinning. We do a plating of tin, or chromium or nickel plating. These less reactive metals or paint or oil, they prevent the surface of iron from getting oxidized, and thus they stop corrosion. But what if the coating gets broken? Whenever the coating gets broken, the rusting starts there. So the second method is coating the metal with a more reactive metal. In case of iron, we generally carry out galvanization, that is zinc, or we coat it with magnesium, a more reactive metal. These more reactive metals, they prevent corrosion even after their coating is found broken. So many a time a question, I'm telling you some questions, kindly remember these questions, and I'll tell you the answer for that also. Like it will be asked from you, what do you understand by cathodic protection of iron? Or give reason why iron does not undergo rusting even if the coating of zinc is found broken at several places. Or give reason why, as it's a very common question, give reason why large magnesium blocks are attached to the hull of ships. Or what do you understand by sacrificial metals? All these questions, they have got the same answer. See, what actually happens? Suppose I have got an iron rod, and this iron rod is coated with, say, zinc. Now it is coated with zinc. This is the zinc coating which is there. So this iron block is coated with zinc. This zinc is more reactive. So it will prevent iron from undergoing oxidation. And it will not allow it to undergo oxidation. But what if the coating gets broken, like in this case? Here, the coating has got broken. Then also iron will not undergo oxidation, because the iron which will undergo oxidation at this place, zinc from some other place will keep on supplying electron to iron here, because zinc is more reactive. So what will happen actually, suppose here in this case, iron is undergoing oxidation and it's getting converted to Fe2 positive. Then zinc from some other place will supply electrons. Then in that case, what will happen? Zn plus Fe2 positive will give you Zn2 positive plus Fe. That means in this case, zinc itself is undergoing oxidation while preventing iron from corrosion. That's why metals like zinc, magnesium, they are known as sacrificial metals, because they are sacrificing themselves in preventing corrosion of iron. And in this case, you'll notice that iron is gaining electrons. In this equation, you can see that iron is gaining electrons. That means iron is behaving like a cathode. And that's why, so in this case, you'll see that iron is gaining electrons and zinc is supplying electrons to iron. That's why it is also known as cathodic protection of iron. In cathodic protection, I'll give you one more example. Like I gave you an example of attaching large magnesium blocks to the hull of ships so as to prevent them from corrosion. Likewise, on railway tracks also we do the similar thing. Either the railway tracks, they are grounded or negative charge is given to them. Or many a time it is observed that a wire is connected to the railway track. It moves inside the ground and there a block of zinc is there with which it is connected. This block of zinc continuously supplies electron to railway track and prevents it from undergoing rusting. So this is what cathodic protection is. Now, apart from this, I would like to tell you one more thing. A very common question is asked. Many times this question has come in exams. Like, why aluminium is used in building purposes? Metals like aluminium and beryllium, they form a layer of their corresponding oxides on their surface. Now, since this layer is covalent, it works like a layer of oil or paint and it prevents them from undergoing rusting. So seldom you'll see that a window pane or a door made up of aluminium will be painted. We never paint it because we need not to paint it. It will not undergo rusting. That layer of Al2O3 or BeO in case of beryllium will prevent them from further oxidation. So this is all about corrosion. After corrosion, I'll give you a brief introduction of some galvanic cells, which are given there in your textbook. We'll see these cells like here. First, we'll see that these cells, they are divided into two parts, that is primary and secondary. Primary cells, they are non-rechargeable. Secondary cells, they are rechargeable. Primary can be used one time and they cost less. You can see that secondary, they are rechargeable, can be used many times, they cost a bit. Now in this, you'll get some examples like dry cell. This is the cell which we generally use in our clocks. Well, in that case, the only thing which you have to remember is the reaction occurring at cathode and anode. So here you can see the reaction occurring at cathode is MnO2 plus ammonium plus electron will give you MnOOH plus NH3. So it is gaining electron, that's why it is acting as a cathode, that is positive terminal. Anode, that is zinc, is losing electrons. After that, I'll show you another cell, that is mercury cell. Well, again, the reaction, they are important at cathode and anode. But in mercury cell, a very common question is asked, give reason why a mercury cell gives constant potential difference throughout its life. If you see the overall reaction of a mercury cell, in this reaction, these reactants, they does not change their concentration. Their concentration does not changes during the reaction. So since the concentration is not changing, so the EMF will also not change. So it is written here, the overall reaction does not involve any ion whose concentration may change. Therefore, this cell gives a constant potential difference of 1.3 volt throughout its life. So if a question is asked, give reason why mercury cell gives constant potential difference throughout its life. That was the answer. Now again, here you will see secondary cell, that these are rechargeable cell, and in this you will see lead storage battery. You will see the reaction occurring at cathode and anode. Cathode, I'll show you. Well, this is the overall reaction, and this is the, here you can see the reaction at anode and cathode. Pb plus SO4 2 negative will give you Pb SO4 plus 2 electron. This is at anode, negative terminal. If we talk about cathode, that is PbO2 plus 4 moles of H positive plus SO4 2 negative plus 2 electrons will give you Pb SO4 plus hydrogen. Overall reaction you can see below this. I would like to tell you one thing. See, this reaction is for discharging of lead storage battery. Many a time a question comes, what will be the reaction during recharging of a lead storage battery? In that case, you will reverse this reaction. That means you will write 2 moles of PbSO4 plus 2H2O will give you Pb plus PbO2 plus 4H positive plus 2SO4. This is for recharging, and we have reversed the first reaction. Then you have got Nicard cell, that is nickel cadmium cell. Here also you have to remember the reaction occurring at anode and cathode. At anode it is cadmium plus 2OH negative, that will give you cadmium hydroxide plus 2 electrons. At cathode it is nickel oxide plus H2O plus 2 electrons, that will give you nickel hydroxide plus 2OH negative. You can see the overall reaction also. So only these are the things which you have to remember in these cells. After this, we'll talk about a fuel cell. Well, as far as a fuel cell is concerned, though we call it a cell, it is very correctly a generator or a dynamo sort of a thing, where you are in a generator, like in a generator you provide fuel and it continuously gives you energy. This what a fuel cell is also. It works on the same principle. You keep on supplying fuel to it, it will keep on giving you electricity. Well, this cell was initially used by NASA during Apollo's programs, because the journey was very long and they need to have some power, continuous power supply. So it was not possible to carry so many batteries on a spaceship, because it will make a large load on it. So they discovered this cell, that is fuel cell, and it works on the rocket fuel, that is liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen. If we talk about its working, then you can see in the diagram that it consists of a container. That container is fitted with two porous pots. These porous pots contains a base, generally potassium hydroxide or sodium hydroxide. From one side we pump in hydrogen, while from the other side we pump in oxygen. The side from where we pump oxygen works as cathode, that is positive terminal, and the porous pot where we are pumping in hydrogen will work as a negative terminal. I'll show you how the reaction they occur. So you can see the reactions, they are written. The reactions they are written on the bottom of this cell. That is 2H2 plus 4 moles of OH negative will give you 4H2O plus 4 electrons. So this is the reaction occurring at anode. That is the porous part towards which we are pumping hydrogen. And the porous part towards which we are pumping oxygen, the reaction there is O2 plus 2H2O plus 4H positive plus 4 electrons will give you 4OH negative. So it will work as a cathode, that is positive terminal. Well, as far a fuel cell is concerned, it is quite efficient cell. If we compare it with thermal power plants, its efficiency is quite high. Thermal power plant, they convert the chemical energy to electrical energy with an efficiency of around 40%. Whereas a fuel cell has got an efficiency somewhere between 70 to 75%. Now new type of fuel cells, they are also tried, where some new catalysts like platinum, palladium, nickel, they are incorporated into these porous pots, so as to increase the rate of reaction. So they means we can say fuel cell are the cells of the future, where they'll replace a large number of energy sources, where they'll be the main energy source. Like a large number of fuel cells, they have been tried in automobiles also. Fuel cell, in fuel cell, apart from hydrogen, we can use methane or methanol also as a fuel. So it continuously burns that fuel and continuously gives you energy. And as far its environment friendliness is concerned, it is quite environment friendly because the byproduct in this case is water vapor. So this is what a fuel cell is. And this is all about electrochemistry chapter. With this, we have finished up with this chapter. Kindly go through the previous lectures also. These lectures which I'm giving you are gonna help you in a great way while revising your chapter. Do the exercise. In coming lectures, I'll be adding some exercise questions also. Like what we'll be doing after finishing a chapter, we'll be doing some important questions from your textbook. You'll get one lecture on those questions also, where I'll be solving those questions and I'll be adding that to the playlist. So thanks a lot. And again, don't forget to subscribe this channel and don't forget to press the bell icon to get all the notifications. Thank you very much.